In this episode, we're going to identify the tools we'll be using for our PC build.
You're watching IT Pro TV.
Hello, ladies and gentlemen. Thank you for tuning in to more of the hands-on PC build. We wanted to take a few moments here and just kind of walk you through some of the tools that we'll be using throughout our build. And one of the things I want to start off by saying is that you could be using some of these. You might not be using any of them. There is one that we'll get into that I definitely want you to use. And the reason I say that is because for the most part, your PC builds today are almost toolless. You don't have to have a lot of tools, a big massive toolkit. Don't need the big mechanic box sitting out in the shop in order to do a lot of the work today. But there are a couple of things that we're going to be using tools for, and those are pretty consistent across most PC builds, and that's going to be a Phillips screwdriver for your motherboard installation, as well as a Phillips screwdriver to install the heatsink on top of the CPU after we get that installed. Now, that being said, even your heatsink, I've seen where they have little latches that don't require any kind of Phillips screwdriver, so just pay attention to your vendor. But let's go ahead and start out with probably one of the most important things we have on the bench right now, and that's going to be, we got a couple different kinds here, that's going to be this right here. All right, this is what's known as an anti-static wrist strap, wristband. You might have heard it called a geek strap before, And what this is used for primarily is to take any static charge that's in your body and then kind of dissipate it away from your body into, well, one of two things. Depending on how you're using it, you could be using it like we are. This big blue mat that you see here, it's actually an anti-static mat. Believe it or not, it's not just here for deco. And that is electrically resistive, and it's going to help keep that static charge from entering any of our components. So that is what we're going to use this one for. Now, if we take a little closer look at this, you're going to see that it really isn't anything too fancy. We'll see that there's a little metal piece on the inside of the strap and the wristband, if you will. And when we put this on, very easy. We just want to make sure that it's good and snug, tighten it up. And you really want to make sure that that metal piece makes contact with your skin. That's very important because any static charge that you have in your body is going to follow this cable. And for us, what we're going to do is we're going to take this connector and this little bundle of black wire here. This is actually an extension that's going to connect to the mat. And what that does is it gives us a little bit more freedom because they can be a little restrictive. So what we do is we take this piece, which is, again, the end of the cord connected to the wristband, and then we just thread it through this little hole right there, and then what we'll do is we'll take the snap side of this right here, and all the way over here in the corner right here on my anti-static mat, we're just going to take it and we're going to snap that down. Now, I will tell you that you could be using another type, and let me kind of just set this to the side for a second and show you. I've got another anti-static strap here, and this is really, they're almost identical, but it has a different type of connector. Notice the post that goes to the extension here that we were using versus this one, which has a clip. And the clip is really simple. I'm sure that most of you are got what this is going to do here. We're just going to take that clip, and what we'll do is we'll clip it down to a bare painted, a bare metal, unpainted portion of the inside of the computer case, tower, chassis, however you want to say that, and then doing the same thing. Again, you can see there's a little metal piece on the inside. So what I would do is I just put this on. And in certain circumstances where you're really worried about static discharge, maybe you would wear two. I'm not going to wear two on this. But notice that same thing, just making contact with the inside of our skin. And then what we would do here is just take that clip and clip it to the inside of the case. Like I said, if you want to see something kind of interesting, it's the same thing, really. I could take that clip off, and then if I take the clip off, we've got two of the same posts here. So just a couple different ways that you can make sure that you are, making sure that more than anything that you are trying to prevent any static discharge from entering your components. And that's very important because it doesn't take very much static electricity in your body to ruin sensitive circuitry. So I will tell you that while you might not have each one of these tools used in your build, I would definitely recommend you having an anti-static wrist strap. And if you want to have a mat, that's perfectly fine. Now, I know that there'll be some people that'll say, well, you know, I don't really use an anti-static wristband. What I do is I just touch the inside of the case, you know, and then I go to work. And that's perfectly fine. That works really well. Just keep in mind that one of the things that I do like about the wrist strap, even though they can be a little bit restrictive, is it makes sure that you just know that any static charge in your body is being just basically shunted to this mat, or if you will, the inside of the case. So it really is about protecting the components that you're working with. Especially if you're working with other people's components there, keep in mind that a processor could be $1,000 and something as simple as 10 volts really could ruin the circuitry inside of that processor. And unfortunately, that's not going to make for a happy customer. And even for myself, that wouldn't make me too happy if I've just wasted that, that component. So things like your CPU, things like your memory modules, they're very susceptible to static discharge, as well as components with on the motherboard. So those definitely, I would have these as part of your tech toolkit. If you're going to be doing a lot of PC builds, it's up to you whether you do that or you do the method where you just ground yourself off to the inside of the case just by touching bare metal on it. Now, for the most part, that's really the majority of our tools. Now, I do got some other tools that we have up here. This is really going to be our main tool for pretty much all of the build. This is just a little Phillips screwdriver. Nothing special about it. I actually got that out of an iFixit kit that I've got over here. You really don't need the whole iFixit kit. You just need the Phillips screwdriver. And that's going to be to install the motherboard. There are some screws that we have to screw down, the mounting points on the inside of the case, as well as in the build that we're going to do, we're going to put in a Cooler Master heat sink, and it requires us to put a backplate on the back of the motherboard, as well as using the Phillips screwdriver to tighten the heat sink down onto the top of the CPU and make that firm connection. Other things that we have here too, this is our directors. In fact, the director here, they bought this for the bench, and I didn't even know these existed, so kudos to them. Nothing crazy about this. This is just a little W52 work light, right? And you can see on the back of there, let me get that there in the camera there, W52, you can check it out. It has a little USB recharge, so you don't need to worry about batteries. And let's face it, guys and gals out there, it's really nothing more than a light. It's got a couple of different settings. It's even got a pointer on there if you happen to point. I've tried to use this before to show things. It really doesn't work, but the bright setting's really good. It helps you to see in some of those cracks and crevices, especially if you've already got a build and maybe you're doing some quality control on it, maybe some maintenance on it, and you want to get down in there and you want to check out the components. So we'll be using this little work light through on and off throughout the series. A couple other things that we're going to be using. We're going to be using thermal compound, and this is Arctic Silver. Let me show you this here. With Arctic Silver here, it's what we're going to put on the CPU, and you don't have to use Arctic Silver. I happen to be using it because I really, really like it. It's a good thermal compound. A lot of times when you buy something like a Cooler Master heat sink, or even sometimes when you buy just components for your CPU, you might see that they include this. I just go ahead and I buy Arctic Silver because I really like this. That's thermal compound. We're going to be putting that on top of the CPU to ensure that there's no air gap in between the top surface area of the CPU and the bottom surface area of the heat sink, and it just bridges that gap and makes sure that we have proper thermal conductivity coming out of the CPU into the heat sink, so the heat sink will do more of the absorption of the heat that's being generated by the CPU. So very, very important to have your thermal compound there. Other things that we're going to be using, again, just a little wire cutter, the wire clippers here. Again, nothing special about this. Really, this is going to be used more for anything than for aesthetic purposes at the end when we do some cable management. I might be using some zip ties just to make sure that we're properly routing the cables in the case so that we're not obstructing the airflow. And let's face it, so it looks good, right? You want to make sure that if you're building a new PC that, you know, it looks really sharp and it looks nice and clean and like we meant to do it. Remember, quality doesn't happen by accident. We actually have to make it happen. Last thing I will say that we're going to use is this little thing right here. This is a Thermaltake Universal ATX power supply tester, and it's got all of the different connections that you can see on your power supply, including the 24-pin main power connector. Now with this, you really don't have to have one of these. I like to use this because as I'm doing a PC build, I plug the power supply into it prior to plugging it into the motherboard to make sure that the power supply is giving the outputs that we expect and that they're within those tolerances. Again, you don't have to have one of these. You could just wait till you plug in your main power connector and all the power connectors to any of the auxiliary components that you're attaching to the motherboard and then turn it on and hope everything works. This, not very expensive. I'll put a link to each one of these just individual, like the ESD or Antistatic straps and the mats so that you can have access to it, and this little Thermaltake Universal ATX power supply tester. Now, we looked at a few of the components, actually really all of the utilities and tools that we're going to use inside of our PC build. Keep in mind that largely speaking today, most of your PC builds are going to be toolless, but there is an occasion that you might be using some of these tools.
Thank you for watching IT Pro TV.